The Tabernacle of David, Burnsville, Minnesota, presents a special video production. Andrew Gabriel Roth. The Egyptian Record of the Exodus. For more information, visit onefaithonepeopleministries.com.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it. All right. Chag Sameach, everybody. Thank you. I got to do a couple little announcements. First of all, for those of you who don't know, my name is Andrew Gabriel Roth. I am the founder and president of One Faith, One People Ministries. I'm very, very pleased to be back here in Minnesota. I did a teaching at Tabernacle of David last August. It was very well received, and I'm very happy that Judah Humango and Bob and Jackie Humango have been so generous to me and have allowed me to come back. So I thank you for that. My wingman over here, my good friend Noe Gonzalez. He's going to be talking about deliverance.
I will catch you later.
This is his debut public speaking, just so you all know. All right? I've done what I can. All right? You know, Noe is the vice president of One Faith, One People Ministries, and really helps me out with a lot of great things, so thank you, Noe. And I also wanted to thank Brian and Angie Usadas. They have graciously put us up at their house. Not only have they put us up, they've put up with us, which is even better. So thank you very much. Appreciate that. And this presentation has kind of an interesting story. And I'm going to kind of get to it indirectly, because some of you might be like, well, this is Exodus. We did that a couple weeks ago. We did that 6-7 weeks. Why am I doing this as my part one? I'm going to try to explain the logic behind this. Obviously, you don't get to Shavuot without going through Pesach. But there's another reason. But let me backtrack just a little bit. You know, one of the things that I teach on very often is what I call placeholders in Scripture. There are times when a certain thing is expected to happen, and it doesn't happen. But then Yahweh, He makes a placeholder for it, and then it happens later. So I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. You guys remember how, you know, Moshe, he goes before Pharaoh, Shalach et ami, let my people go, right? So that they may go celebrate a feast to me in the wilderness. Remember that? He makes that request about 5 times. Feast never happens. They never get to do that feast in the wilderness. But that's okay. Now, when I did calendar calculations, because that's a hobby / obsession of mine, and if I do too much of it, I won't leave the house, I realized that they were supposed to do this feast the full moon before they left. Well, that is known today as Purim. That was the feast, so Yahweh just held it in place, held that occasion in place, and waited about 1,000 years till he could do that miracle in Persia. Now, to me, what that tells me is that every spring full moon, regardless as to how the year falls in the Hebrew year, you're going to have a deliverance feast for the Jewish people. It's either going to be the story of the deliverance from Persia or the story of the deliverance from Egypt. It's a placeholder. This is kind of a placeholder, too. I had prepared, anyone who has to do teachings like these, you don't just prepare, you over-prepare. You don't want to be stuck out here in front of 50, 60 people with not enough stuff to talk about. So we did a conference in Charleston, South Carolina, called Exodus Revealed. And I had prepared more teachings than I had time to give. This being one of them. So now, at the end of Pesach season, this was the placeholder for me to do what I had planned to do then. Now, I also wanted to share something with you that I got this which is a DVD of my first day's teaching that was also done at the Exodus conference, Exodus Revealed. And this is called Exodus, A Historical and Archaeological Journey. Now, before anyone asks me, Andrew, why are you showing a product on a high Shabbat? I want to let you know I am not selling this. You cannot buy this, which is why I'm giving it away. So there are DVDs for each of you, one per household, totally free, as a gift from One Faith, One People Ministries. So I just want to let you know that that's what this is. So with all that said, I'm going to talk about a very surprising story. The Egyptian record of the Exodus. Now people go, Andrew, there is no such thing. There is. You know, how many times have we heard these skeptics with their academic degrees insist there's not a scrap of evidence from Egypt that Moshe ever lived or that the Exodus ever happened? Or if it did, it was greatly exaggerated and mythologized. Have we not all heard this? Okay. So let's get into this. Now, when, you know, I had planned to do this at the Exodus Reveal Conference, and I had gone through all this archaeological evidence, which is why that slide reads the way that it does. You know, I gave evidence that the Hebrews were slaves in Egypt during the exact time that the scripture says, and now I'm going to address other false claims by biblical skeptics. And I'm going to address them head on. Evidence for evidence, point for point, logic for logic. So these skeptics, these liberal historians who insist that Moshe was made up, they basically insist that everything before maybe the late period of the kingdom of Judah was a total myth, right? And they say again, not a trace of Exodus in any Egyptian sources. And I say, not any Egyptian sources? Because they kind of were around for 3,000 years, okay? Not any Egyptian sources. Absolutely no trace of it, Andrew. And I'm like, really? Okay. Let me prove you wrong. It's simply not true. There are, in fact, Egyptian sources that mention Moshe. They mention Hebrew slaves. They even fill in missing areas of Moshe's life that are not in the Torah. And not only that, this same source that scholars say doesn't exist, turns out when they need it for their chronology for what king ruled in what dynasty, it all of a sudden pops into existence and they use it. But when it comes to saying Moshe was a real person, oh, there is no record of it. If that sounds surprising, trust me, you're not alone. Our churches, our synagogues, Hebrew Roots Assemblies, have not done the best job that they could teaching the flocks about what the hard archaeological historical evidence is. We're either told to take it on faith, you know, just don't believe those naysayers, just take it on faith, and I'm all for taking things on faith. But I also know I am commanded to search the Word and to prove all things. And that is what I'm here to do today. So the skeptics are certainly not going to volunteer the weak parts of their argument. So we can't expect them to tell you where the proverbial bodies are buried. But that's my job. They're not going to admit this without a fight. So let's bring it. But the evidence is out there. If you know where to look and you have the courage to see it for what it really is, not only did the Egyptians know about the Exodus, they passed it down in great detail, but from their own perspective. Right? There's a bit of spin control going on. And they passed it down for many centuries. But they also tried, at the time, to cover up the truth. So there was a cover-up at the time, but the story kept getting passed down, generation after generation. let me show you why. With this guy named Manetho. Okay? Remember this guy, Manetho, because he's our source. He's one of the sources. So we begin our journey with what seems a perfect storm of irony, inconsistency, bad academic politics. Manetho is a Greek-Egyptian historian who many believe was active during the reigns of the first two Ptolemaic rulers from about 323 to 246 BC. His Egyptian name is lost. This Manetho is the Greek version of his Egyptian name. It was believed to be mean, possibly beloved of Neith, which is a goddess, Manetho. We know almost nothing about Manetho's life. But the little bit that we do know about this guy has a huge impact in the world of Egyptology. Somewhere around 450 BC, you had a Greek guy write one of the earliest travel magazines in the history of the world. His name was Herodotus. And he went to ancient Egypt. And he wrote down all this stuff that he saw there. Now, Herodotus' beauty is in the eye of the beholder. He's really controversial. Some people like him, call him the father of history. Other people call him the father of lies. Right? Manetho is in Camp B. Manetho does not like Herodotus. Okay? He actually wrote a book called Against Herodotus. Okay? Now, Manetho's only chronicler, the way that we know about Manetho's writings today, comes only from one source, the Jewish historian Josephus. First century Jewish eyewitness, descended from priests and kings on both sides of his family tree. Josephus is absolutely critical in my studies. You know, so is his predecessor, a guy named Philo. They call them Joe and Phil, right? What are you doing? I'm talking with Joe and Phil, hon. That's what I'm doing, right? Now, Josephus and Manetho have something in common. When they get mad, they write these long essays about that terrible person. I can't believe he said that. So when Josephus got mad, he got mad at a racist guy named Apion, and so he wrote a book called Against Apion. Ironically, if Joe had just kept his mouth shut, we never would have heard of Apion. He's our only source that Apion ever existed. And if Manetho had kept quiet, then we wouldn't have even known about his history. Right? Because he, as I said, he wrote against Herodotus. After that, Manetho then wrote this book he's most famous for. A book that is required reading for every single professional Egyptologist on the face of the earth. It's called Egyptian History. Okay? And it's all a list of kings. Who ruled in what dynasty for how long? Okay? Manetho is one of only about six sources. That's it. The Egyptologists have six sources that they can draw their king's list from. Manetho being one of the most trusted resources that they have. Now, those six sources are, just to give you a quick rundown, they have something called the Palermo Stone, which lists the ancient kings of what we call the Old Kingdom, first couple of dynasties. They've got another list in stone at a temple in a place called Karnak. They've got another fragmentary list called the Turin Canon, and they have still another list called the Abydos List that was done by a pharaoh named Seti I and his son Ramesses. And that particular list basically excludes a lot of what they would call less worthy kings. So they have a sanitized version of Egyptian history. They are deliberately rewriting their own history. We're going to be getting back to that tendency of the Egyptians covering up stuff they don't like. But they don't cover it up completely. And then, number five, Manetho. That's it. That's those are the sources that they got. Okay? But to be fair, you could look at when they like every once in a while they find a new tomb. That's a source of history too, like King Tut's tomb. But in Tut's case, ironically, King Tut, the most famous pharaoh of them all, because we found his tomb intact. Everybody knows King Tut. And yet, King Tut didn't make the official king's list that we were just talking about. They dropped him off. So here's a guy that they literally tried to drop out of the historical record because of what his rebel dad did, a guy named Akhenaten. And yet, Tut ends up outshining just about everybody because we happened to find his tomb. So if Manetho is one of these trusted sources, which doesn't mean they agree with everything that Manetho believed. That's another topic. But in terms of the raw data, they totally trust Manetho. And Manetho says Moshe was real. The Exodus happened. Why won't they believe him? I mean, make up your mind, guys. You're going to use him for A. Why don't you use him for B? Makes no sense to me. So Josephus says, Manetho acknowledged Moshe to have been a real person, a prince, and a priest of Egypt, who led his enslaved brethren out of the country with miracles and banned them from worshiping idols. More than that, Josephus lists two other Egyptian sources confirming these basics as facts. On the other hand, Josephus admits he has certain problems with the Egyptian record of the Exodus. Well, so do I. But that doesn't mean there is no trace of it. And that's my point. There is a record of it. Okay? Manetho names both the pharaoh who drove Moshe out to Midian, he calls him Thutmoses, and he also names the pharaoh of the Exodus, a guy named Amenhotep. Each one of these pharaohs, at least in my chronology, is on the throne the exact year that these things happened, because the scripture tells us exactly the year of the Exodus, beyond any doubt. But in the interest of fairness and full disclosure, there are challenges that must be addressed. So, I'm not saying it's ideal. I'm saying it exists. To begin with, Josephus doesn't have Manetho there to discuss certain details in person because a couple of centuries separate these guys. So, he says, quote, "I will set down his very words as if I were to bring the very man himself into a court for a witness." Right? Well, that's kind of wishful thinking on Josephus' part because Manetho's kind of been dead for 200 years. But that's what he feels he's going to do. You're talking about this guy, Josephus, had the last surviving copy of this resource. And thank heaven he decided to use it. So this, of course, again, three centuries separate the two men, and then we have to rely on Josephus' understanding of documents that we can no longer check. They're gone. Manetho then gives information that is not explained by Josephus. Like, there's this really weird line that the Exodus was, quote, 393 years before Danaus came to Argos. Okay. And I'm into ancient history, and that's obscure even to me. Danaus came to Argos? What the heck is that? It sounds like a historical and datable event. Trust me, I tried. But it isn't. Okay? When Danaus came to Argos is a famous Greek myth, which happens to involve the origin story of Egypt. The name was derived from Danaus' brother, whose name was Aegyptus. That's where you get Egypt. Not surprisingly, there's no way to know if this account ever happened or if it did when. It's kind of like trying to find King Arthur. You know, you got all these legends. Where's the guy? Right? So if Manetho had understood in his mind when Danaus went to Argos, he didn't write it down. He just said, well, everybody knows Danaus went to Argos. I don't need to explain any more than that. And so if Benito didn't tell him, Joe doesn't know. So it doesn't help us. So here's the next problem. We have more on Josephus' side for this problem. Since he can't discuss things with Benito, he has no choice but to write down exactly what he has, verbatim, even if it has some bad information. And he just passes it on intact. So, while there's little doubt that Benito is broadly accurate with the names of the kings, their groupings into respective dynasties, pretty much accurate on how long each king ruled in each of those dynasties, it's what Benito assumes around his information, the structure of his information, that needs to be corrected. Here are the bad assumptions that Benito makes, and Joe has no choice but to pass on exactly as he saw it. Benito assumes, one, there's only one king on the throne at any given time. Two, no co-regencies happened. Never. 3,000 years of history, no co-regencies. Okay? Three, only one dynasty ruling in any one time, and each dynasty ruled over the entire country of Egypt throughout their entire reign. But the facts are, there are times when more than one king is ruling at once. Many, in fact, that's going to throw off your chronology. There are many co-regencies, and even crediting the years of one king's reign to the next king, where they just take 20 years and add it to their own reign. Happens all the time. And three, there are dynasties ruling in the same area at once, rival dynasties in other parts of Egypt ruling at once. At one point during what we call the second intermediate period, I count five dynasties ruling at pretty much the same time in different places. You think that's going to throw the numbers off? How could it not? So since Josephus has no choice but to just copy what he has or risk accusations of being unfair, he inherits and passes on these same bad assumptions. Josephus also probably couldn't even read hieroglyphics. He was therefore not in a position to go to Egypt to correlate Manetho's account with actual inscriptions. But we can. So we actually have a leg up on Joe. See? Sometimes also Josephus inherits exaggerated claims of antiquity from pagan sources and passes that information on intact as well. Benito therefore bears this testimony, he writes, to two points of the greatest consequence to our purpose and those from the Egyptian records themselves. In the first place, Josephus says, that we came out of another country into Egypt, and that with all our deliverance out of it was so ancient in time, get a load of this, as he says, the Exodus preceded the siege of Troy by almost 1,000 years. Really? No doubt the ancient Greeks thought their myths came from a much more ancient period than they were in. From a time when the world would have been new and all that. Josephus builds on this, I believe, excessively and to his own advantage by putting the Exodus a millennium earlier, which even if the true date of Troy's fall was used as a marker, is way too early for Moshe and the Exodus. This is a huge problem. Thanks to a guy named Heinrich Schliemann, he discovered... It's okay. I'll tell you again about Heinrich Schliemann. He discovered Troy in the late 1800s. We now have solid evidence dating Troy's fall to about 1200 B.C., now, if the Exodus is 1,000 years earlier, that would put the Exodus at 2200 BCE. That's about 300 years before Abraham's born. And that's across the board. That is mainstream chronology, folks. I don't know. That seems a bit excessive to me. Either way, whether by Manito's assumptions or Josephus's preferences, we need to sift through the data carefully before we make a judgment. And finally, there is more than one account given of what Manito said, as well as other accounts with a different opinion. Here's quoting from Josephus in his book Against Apion. You know, if he could have gotten away with just calling it Apion the Jerk, he would have. Okay? But Against Apion sounds a little nicer. He says, I shall therefore here bring in Manito again. When his people or shepherds were gone out of Egypt to Jerusalem, Tethmosis or Thutmosis, the king of Egypt, who drove them out. So the king of Egypt drives them out. I think that's funny. Reigned afterwards 25 years, 4 months, and then died. But now look at this account. Here's another version. Josephus says, and now I am done with Manito, and I'll inquire what this other historian, a guy named Cherimon, says. For he also, when he pretended to write Egyptian history, he pretended to write history. So you get a little editorial license going there, Joe. Okay. Sets down the same name for this king that Manito did, Amenophis, or Amenhotep, right? And also his son Ramesses. And it goes on this way. The goddess Isis appeared to Amenhotep, Amenophis, in his sleep, and blamed him that her temple had been demolished in the war, but that this other dude, Fritfanes, the sacred scribe, said to him that in case he would purge Egypt of men that had pollutions upon them, meaning leprosy. So the Hebrews had leprosy, and being good Egyptians, we of course kicked those lepers out. he should no longer be troubled by any such frightful apparitions, like the gods and goddesses should stop complaining. I kicked those lepers out, basically. That Amenophis accordingly chose 250,000 of those who were thus diseased and cast them out of the country. It's a much better version from the Egyptian point of view. And that Moses and Joseph were scribes. Joseph was a sacred scribe, and their names were Egyptian, that Moses had been called Tisithon and Joseph Petiseph. They're just making that part up, obviously. We know that Joseph dies 144 years before Exodus even happens, so they're not contemporaries at all, and that Joseph's Egyptian name was Zaphnath-Paneah, not this thing. So, and Josephus knows this. He writes about the exact events in Genesis. So Josephus calls this Amenophis fictitious in one place, but then records him as a real guy in another place. Make up your mind, Joe. Tell me what's going on. But since we don't have Manetho's actual works to look at directly, it's also possible Josephus misunderstood what Manetho said. As we see here with this parallel reference to the same event. Again, Manetho says the Jews departed out of Egypt in the reign of Thutmosis. There's four guys who are called Thutmosis. Okay? 393 years before Danaus fled to Argos. Thank you. Still not helpful. Okay? Because again, we don't know when that was. Well, which is the pharaoh of the Exodus? Thutmosis or Amenhotep? Those are two completely different guys. Josephus says Manetho forgot. But maybe the memory issue is with Joe. You know, not eating enough fish or something. Because the biblical sources, they point to the first as the one who ejected Moshe, and the other is the Exodus Pharaoh. Admittedly, there are many pharaohs with both names. You could confuse Thutmosis the first with Thutmosis the second, Ramses the first with Ramses the ninth, and so on and so forth. Very easy to do. Nevertheless, it seems far more likely to me that the name could be accurately preserved for the pharaoh who made Moshe flee to Midian, and for the other pharaoh Moshe faces down 40 years later, that there is a core of historical memory there. Okay, but these other details, perhaps due to multiple sources, confusing agendas, stuff that got lost, simply got misread. You know, and that's a very, very human thing to do. But there's one other factor in assessing this data that needs addressing. When Josephus is writing this, he's not being a clinical historian. He's mad. He is furious. Okay? Just like Benito was angry at Herodotus, you know, they're not trying to be news anchors and, you know, have all this objectivity sit behind a desk like this. You know, they're like, how dare you? Right? So, just like Benito's angry at Herodotus, Josephus is angry with Benito and with this other historian, Apion, and with another historian named Chaeremon. And so, but with Apion, he named the book after him. Let me show you how angry Joe gets. This is why he needs coffee. Okay? He says, I have also made a refutation of Benito and Chaeremon and of certain others of our enemies. Okay. I shall now therefore begin a confutation of the remaining authors who have written anything against us, although I confess I've had doubt upon me about Apion, the grammarian, whether I ought to take even the trouble of refuting him or not. For some of his writings contain much the same accusations which the others have laid against us. Some things that he had added are very frigid and contemptible. And for the greatest part of what he says, it's very scurrilous. And to speak no more than the plain truth, it shows him to be a very unlearned person. Yeah. And what he writes looks like the work of a man of very bad morals. And of no one better in his whole life than a charlatan. Okay? So in one place, Josephus has packed all his anger into this one cute little paragraph. Right? I mean, can you imagine if he had Facebook? Can you imagine the Against Apion page? You know? My goodness. So in one convenient place, Joe says, Manito and Chaeremon are my enemies. Apion is worse, but he's probably a waste of breath or ink to even make an effort to prove him wrong. And in one exclusive rant dedicated just to this poor guy Apion, I mean, the dude is a racist, but, you know, I kind of feel sorry for him the way Josephus beats him like a drum here. Josephus says, calls him a frigid and contemptible teller of lies, a scurrilous writer, an unlearned person, a man of bad morals. Are they running for president or something? Right? Don't vote for Apion. Right. And my personal favorite, a lifelong charlatan. Okay. Don't mince words, Joe. Please, say what you really feel. Right? But to be fair to Joe, I understand why he's mad. But you see, here's the thing. History is about them, Joe. It's not about you. It's kind of important to leave passion like this out of the discussion, as historians today would. Right? On the other hand, I admit there are parts of this Egyptian story that tempt me to cry anti-Semitism. But other parts actually seem historically plausible, even factual. We're going to have to separate the wheat from the chaff here. Okay? Here's some of what Manetho says. It now remains that I debate with Manetho about Moses. Now the Egyptians acknowledge him to have been a wonderful and divine person. He's a real guy. Nay, they would willingly lay claim to him themselves, though after a most abusive and incredible manner. And they pretend that Moses, he was of Heliopolis, and one of the priests of that place, and was ejected out of it, among the rest, on account of his leprosy. Okay? That's their spin control. Right? Now, Manetho says, here's another quote, that the king's desire in seeing the gods was the origin of the ejection of the polluted people, the leprous Israelites. But Chaeremon feigns that it was a dream of his own, sent upon him by Isis, that was the occasion of it. Now this is just a small little sampling of the material Josephus gives us from Manetho, and it gets a lot worse from what I said. This is the G-rated version. This is Disney quoting Joe. Quoting Manetho. Okay? But staying on point, I can understand why Josephus would have a lot of problems with this. He's not going to be happy about this. He doesn't like Moshe being born Egyptian. It's against the Torah. He's not born Egyptian. A pagan priest, eek, ejected out of Egypt with the Hebrews due to leprosy, and exiled by the wrath of the Egyptian gods. Three are lies. But the fourth, that's a fast. It's kind of like the old thing on Sesame Street. Three of these things are all together. Three of these things are kind of the same. But here's the one that's sort of different. Right? In fact, I think Josephus is so angry that he almost completely glosses over, although he reports it, he doesn't incorporate the good testimony that they have in Egypt about Moshe. Right? And for less onerous ideas about the great prophet, Josephus dismisses them out of hand. Fruit from the poison tree. Right? Even when strong evidence from scripture and history suggests it really could be true. Again, that's why it's called the Egyptian record of the Exodus. So up here we have Josephus remains furious with a bevy of false charges leveled against his people by Egyptian racists. To be fair, the Egyptians were racist to everybody. Okay? The Egyptians, to give you an idea, Egyptologists were finding that there was not just like the big tomb walls with the kings and all the cool hieroglyphs, but they also found letters from parents to children, workers, artisans. We got all like these common people that are leaving records behind. And there was this one father who was writing to his son who was a soldier. And he was upset that his kid had not checked in with dad enough. So he says, "Why are you out there in that horrible place called Yar and you haven't written back to me?" Right? So the Egyptians try to figure out, the Egyptologists, where would this guy have served in the Egyptian army? Where is Yar? And so they went, it seems to be like right near Nubia. Okay. But then they had other references to Yar that weren't anywhere near Nubia. They were all the way up north. They were out west. They were out east. And this was like confusing the Egyptologists. How can Yar be in all these places? And the answer that they got was, Yar was not a place. Yar was a description. And they translated it as, roughly, hellhole. What is hellhole? Anywhere outside of Egypt is hell. Okay? So they basically looked at, if you weren't from Egypt, you were a barbarian, as far as they were concerned. They found one king, a Mycenaean king, who was so rich and powerful, they went, yeah, he's okay. But everybody else, they literally turned their noses down at. That's how they were. So they are equally opportunity snobs. That's the way the ancient Egyptians were. But one fact reported in multiple Egyptian sources seems to find confirmation in the writings of Josephus' mentor, the other Jewish historian, Philo of Alexandria, and also in the actual scripture itself. First, here are the rest of the citations about the lie that actually might be true, might be confirmed. But when these men were gotten into it, they found the place fit for a revolt. They appointed themselves a ruler out of the priests of Heliopolis, whose name was Osar Sif. And they took their oaths that they would be obedient to. It is also reported that the priest who ordained the polity of their laws and was by birth of Heliopolis, his name was Osar Sif from Osiris, who was the god of Heliopolis. But that when he was gone over to these people, his name was changed and he was called Moses. And for that priest, here's another quote, who settled the polity of their laws. Again, he was by birth of Heliopolis. His name was Osiris. but he changed his name to Moses. Moshe, a pagan priest, dedicated to Osiris, serving at the temple at Heliopolis. As shocking as that sounds, it's not that far-fetched. It may, in fact, be biblical. After all, another guy, Joseph, married a priestess at Heliopolis. It was called On. You might remember that in Genesis. Right? She was named Asenath. And there's no evidence that Asenath stopped being a priestess at On after she married Joseph. And then there's this. And he set over them taskmasters who should afflict them in their works. This is familiar. This is Exodus 1:11, but this is the Septuagint version. And they built strong cities for Pharaoh, Pithom, Ramesses, and On, which is Heliopolis. That's from 260 BC. The reading is not found in any later sources, including the Aramaic Old Testament, and it's not found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. This is actually an older reference than the Dead Sea Scrolls. It's not found in the Aramaic Targums that became popular in the early centuries of the Common Era. And yet, in many cases, the Septuagint does open a window to how the older, now lost Hebrew version actually read. And it's very helpful for that. But it's still a translation from an earlier Hebrew source. We always need to bear that in mind. So if that's the case, it may have been edited out by later Jewish authorities because it's kind of embarrassing that their people... Okay, store cities for grain. That's pretty humble, you know. Yeah, we can do the store cities. But a pagan astronomical learning center? The pagan Silicon Valley of its day? And the Hebrews are building it? And also the geography matches. Guess what? Pithom, Ramesses, and Heliopolis, they're in the same... They're within 5 miles of each other. That could be true. And that's where Joseph and the Hebrew slaves were, in Goshen. So that's one of the gateway, the reconstruction of what one of those gateways would have looked like. However, even if the Greek reading of Exodus 1:11 is discarded, the rest of the evidence forms a strong circumstantial case for Moshe having been a priest at On. Again, this is before Yahweh calls him. Yahweh hasn't reached out to him yet. He's a prince of Egypt. We need to meet him on the terms of those circumstances if we're going to understand what his early life was like. Right? Just like his great-great-grandaunt Asenath was at Heliopolis too. So first, as I said, Moshe didn't know Abba Yahweh his first 40 years. And it was not only normal for princes to join in these cults, it was actually required. Okay? The two major astronomy cults were one for the god of the moon and the other for the god of the sun. That doesn't sound too shocking. Right? And the god of the sun, Ra, was worshipped at Heliopolis. But Moshe wasn't named after Ra. He was named after Osiris. And that's because when the sun is fully set in Egyptian myth, it becomes Osiris. So Ra is where the sun is when it's overhead, and then when it's fully set and night is coming, it becomes Osiris. Go figure. So Moshe had to join these cults to get astronomical knowledge, which we know he had per Acts 7, verse 22. Because it tells us that. He had all the wisdom of the Egyptians. Tell me how that wisdom is not going to include astronomy. Right? And that's why I have that on the next slide. Moshe was trained in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was prepared in his words and in his deeds. Now, listen to the words of Philo, who actually was going from records that we no longer have about Moshe's training as a young man in Egypt. He says, "But On, or Heliopolis, was said to be a hill, and it means symbolically to the mind, for all the reasonings are stored up in the mind, And the lawgiver himself is a witness of this, calling on Heliopolis, the city of the sun. For when the sun, when he rises, shows visibly the things which have been hidden by the night. And so also the mind, sending forth its own proper light, causes all bodies and all things to be seen visibly at a distance. Of course, one can argue that Philo, who read the Septuagint, may have been influenced by that reading that the Hebrews built. Also, they built up Heliopolis. That's possible. Fortunately, though, this isn't the only place that Philo talks about Moshe's training. This is what Moshe's routine was like, according to 2,000-year-old record here. Accordingly, Moshe speedily learned arithmetic, geometry, the whole science of rhythm and harmony and meter, the whole of music by means of use of musical instruments, and by lectures on different arts, and by explanations of each topic, and lessons on these subjects were given to him by Egyptian philosophers who taught him philosophy, which is contained in their symbols, or hieroglyphics. So Moshe could read hieroglyphics. And the knowledge of the heavenly bodies, so much studied by the Chaldeans, or the Babylonians, if you prefer. And this knowledge he also derived from the Egyptians, who study mathematics above all things. And he learned the great accuracy of the state-of-the-art art among both the Chaldeans and the Egyptians. And where did he learn? Heliopolis. Right. Not only is Heliopolis the most expert astronomy place Moshe could go, it was also the nearest, a couple miles from where he's being raised. However, it's fair to look at the other side of the issue, because Exodus 2 verse 10 tells us that Moshe's name was called that because he was drawn from the water. Right? And because I drawed you out of the water, I call you Moshe. Right? But you see, that happened. I agree. Of course I agree. Scripture. But Moses would have been a nickname. It wasn't his Egyptian name. Okay? It's a nickname between himself and his adopted mother. The drawn from water meaning is correct. Hebrew Moses does mean to be drawn out of the water. No question. However, even leading rabbis know that Moshe is an Egyptian name, not a Hebrew one. Okay? The Hebrew word Moshe would not work for the name of an Egyptian prince, possibly next in line to be Pharaoh. For a simple reason, there was a commandment to kill all Hebrew infant males. Wasn't there? So it might get the princess, his adopted mother, banished or executed, you think, for defying the command of Pharaoh to kill all Hebrew infants? This is why Moshe is derived from an Egyptian word, Meses, which means to be born from, to be the son or daughter of. Okay? It's from this Egyptian word, Meses, sometimes called Moses, that we get the name of actual pharaohs, Thutmoses. Right? Born of Toth. Or the other way to pronounce it, Meses. Ra Meses. Ramesses. So, born of Ra. Such a designation was actually required. Moshe had no choice in this, any more than Joseph didn't have any choice but to accept his Egyptian name. I'm sure Joseph wasn't thrilled that pagans were giving him a name, but what could he do? Right? Moshe could not be a prince of Egypt without being connected to an Egyptian god. It's as simple as that. If he took on a Hebrew name, they could kill him. So then when we then ask the logical question, namely, which Egyptian god was Moshe named after? He had to be named after one of them. He's born of something. He doesn't know Yahweh yet. No one in his Egyptian family knows Yahweh yet. So what are they going to do? Manetho tells us he's named after Osiris. And in ancient Egyptian, his actual name would have been Hek Asiri Meses, Prince Asiri, the son of Osiris. Later, when Moshe fled Egypt, he simply dropped Asiri and kept Moses. went back to his nickname. Does that make sense? I know that's a little bit atypical from what you might have been taught. But this is what the Egyptian records tell us, and I'm just scratching the surface here. So not only has Benito helped us recover data about the historical Moshe, he may have also revealed to us the actual name much of their records contained regarding Moshe, Assyrimaces, crown prince of the two lands. So if you ever find hieroglyphs with that designation, that's him. But who is Prince Assyrimaces? How does he relate to the Hebrew Moshe? Well, at the Exodus Revealed Conference, that was the next presentation, okay? But we're going to move on to Shavuot itself in part two. So what I'm going to say is, you know, people will say, well, it's a later record. Manetho's writing 1,000 years, you know, 900 years, whatever it is, after the events. But now you're changing your story. Before you said, no record in Egyptian sources of the Exodus. None. Then I pushed back. And now all of a sudden, well, we don't think it's that reliable. But you use him to date your kings. Well, it's still a late source. Okay, so, you know, I don't know. You know, I just hope you never get in trouble with the law, because if you ever get into a court of law, you're going to be telling so many different versions of what you supposedly mean. It's going to totally shoot your credibility, I think, you know, talking back to the skeptics here. Okay, let's be real. And yet, when we are people of faith, we're the ones who they say aren't logical. Right? Oh, they're just a bunch of faith people. They don't really know any history. I'm going, well, really? What do you think? Right? What basically happened is that the Egyptians, as I said, at the time, they covered it up. They covered up Exodus. That's another story, but I'll just tell you the thumbnail thing here. Their whole society was based on preserving Pharaoh's body for the afterlife. If Pharaoh doesn't get to do his little trip to the gods, Egypt is destroyed. Now, imagine your Pharaoh has drowned in the Sea of Reeds and you can't find his body because it's totally gone. You think you're going to cover that up? Because I'm going to tell you something. They covered up a lot less and we caught them red-handed. They had a female be Pharaoh. Oh my goodness. Dropped her off the king's list. Destroyed her monuments. Her name was Hatshepsut. Right? Though they had a boy king, but his father, Akhenaten, believed in one god. Cross Akhenaten off the king's list, and cross King Tut off of the king's list too. Again, that's minor. But this, their whole culture, their whole civilization is on the line with the disaster that one of their own princes made the Pharaoh let the slave population go, okay, because a god they never heard of commanded them to do it. So what did they do? Spin control. Right? That's what they did. It's sort of like going, what did the Egyptians know, and when did they know it? Right? So this is, at the time, they covered up so many lesser scandals that we later found from other sources that had actually happened. If they're going to cover that up, we better believe they're going to cover this up. But the story was so powerful that even the Egyptians couldn't stamp it out altogether. They couldn't. So it got passed down century after century, dynasty after dynasty. But they tweaked it. You know, the rabbis kind of did that with Yeshua. You might have heard of something called the Toldot Yeshu, where the rabbis do a parody on the Gospels. And as time goes on, they make it more favor their position. Same exact same thing happens here. They keep tweaking the story until it sounds more pro-Egyptian. And then a guy named Manetho, who has access to those documents and may have translated them from hieroglyphics. He writes it down, and Josephus picks it up. And so there is an Egyptian record of the Exodus. So that's the end of part one. Thank you for listening. We can either eat or... Have anyone got any questions about this? Yeah, all those. Huh?
Is there a translation meaning of that Egyptian name?
Of Zaphnath-Paneah? Yes. I believe, you know, I've looked at this for quite a while, and I believe that Joseph is named after this deity Neth, because Neth was in charge of the harvest, and there he is storing grain. And that's what they do. Jacob also has an Egyptian name, his father. That's another story. So what the Egyptians would do is they would look at who the person is, right? Just this foreigner, figure what is he into, and then they would pick a deity that seemed to match what the guy was like. So Zaphnath-Paneah means Neth speaks and he lives. So in other words, the goddess of the harvest speaks, and because Joseph is storing the grain, he lives. That's what I think the name is. That's my opinion. Any other questions? Yes?
Moses was, you described Moses as being so educated. Why would he defer to his brother that he speak for him when he was so highly trained?
Well, he kind of has a little bit of an inferiority complex. Moshe is said to be the most humble man on the planet, right? But sometimes you can be too humble. I know, but most of us will never fall into that category. So, too humble? What are you talking about? I'm the most humble man I know. No. But this is what happens. When he meets Yahweh at the burning bush, this is what I call the worst job interview in the history of the world. Okay? He gives 5 direct excuses and 2 indirect excuses why he doesn't want the job. Right? They won't know your name. I stutter. You know, yeah, you know, who am I? They just send someone else. I'm whatever. You know. And so this is his humility has made him so humble that Moshe is like scared almost. And so Yahweh says to him, your brother Aaron's coming. He speaks well. He's not a stutterer. So if you're really worried about what you're going to... I already told you I'm going to be with you. I gave you 2 miracles to go, you know, and show them. But no, that's not enough for you. So I'm going to have Aaron speak for you. It wasn't that Moshe wasn't qualified to speak. Yahweh had decided Moshe was qualified to speak. But Moshe himself wasn't sure that he could speak. So that's why Aaron was pressed. One more thing about that. Has anyone noticed that shouldn't Aaron not be able to travel to Midian? Isn't he kind of, a slave? You know, like, hey, there he is, just hitting the highway, yep. Hey guys, love to have you whip my back, but I'm on my way to Midian. You ever wonder why? Because I might have an answer for that. Okay. Why? Okay. Here's why. My opinion. Okay. So you have Moshe's adopted mom, the daughter of Pharaoh, who I believe is a lady named Hatshepsut. Now, she hires Moshe's mother to nurse the infant while he's being weaned. The Egyptians, like the Hebrews, would wean a child for 5 years. Okay? That's why, if you look in Leviticus 27, the value of an infant male goes up when he turns 5, because that's when he's weaned. Okay? So, what happened was, Hatshepsut is openly defying the commandment of her father, who happens to be king. If word gets out that she's done this, she could be dead. So what does she do? She hires on Moshe's family. And in return for their silence, okay, and for having Yocheved nurse Moshe, she gives them freedom. She makes an agreement, and that's why Aaron is able to walk about freely. He had a special dispensation from the princess. Just an idea. Any other questions? Yes?
This isn't really a question.
Okay.
I feel it's from the Lord. After Andrew was here in August, I started listening to his stories and teachings each week. And any of you are interested in that, I mean, it has truly changed my life. I look forward to it every week. It's also podcastable, so I download it on my phone. My kids download music, and I listen to it when I'm gardening or outside doing chores or whatever. I mean, this guy is incredible. He's super humble. He's fun. He's interested. And he's always looking to learn. And I hope I've said it correctly.
Thank you. Yeah, it's called One Faith, One People Ministries. And thank you very much for saying that. It's my joy and my honor to do the Torah every week. And what we try to do is what you just saw. You know, I look at the scripture, I look at the historical record, sometimes I get into astronomy, archaeology, all of this sort of stuff to try to bring the Bible alive. And so we do one program called Scroll to Scroll, which is the long lesson, right, for about 3 hours or so. Video one, Torah. Video two, Prophets, the New Covenant. And then I do what I call Torah 101, which is the basic course. It's usually about an hour. And everything's got MP3s and notes that average about 25 pages every week. Maybe a little less, but somewhere in there. My holiday specials, it's like a lot of trees died to make those notes, you know. So trust me. But that's what we do. And you can go to that site and find out more about that.
OneFaithOnePeopleMinistries.com.
But it is a high Shabbat, so I don't want to. Okay. I'm just being careful.
It's for.
But there's free teachings up there too, just so you know, lots of free teachings. So hopefully that helped. Yeah?
For more information, visit OneFaithOnePeopleMinistries.com.